Get your tissues ready because spring has sprung. Hey guys, Tara here for D News, and it is officially that time of year. The birds are chirping, the flowers are blooming, and if you're anything like me, your nose is a disgusting faucet of never-ending liquids. But before you go blaming pollen for those pesky seasonal allergies, remember, you have no one to blame but yourself. So what's happening inside your body when you experience allergies? Well, in short, it's basically one giant misunderstanding. The first time you're exposed to an allergen, your immune system investigates that allergen and produces specific antibodies for it, which are special cells designed to detect and stop foreign invasion. Typically, this is a good thing. It's what prevents you from getting sick. But in the case of allergies, your immune system mistakes innocuous things like pollen or cat dander for a serious threat. And in response to that threat, your plasma cells release a flood of these antibodies that attach to the surface of your mast cells, causing them to burst open and release a flood of histamine. Histamine is what causes the swelling that leads to various allergy-like symptoms, like runny nose, sneezing, or hives. But why do some people have such bad allergies and others none at all? There's no cut and dry answer to that question, but genetics and environment seem to play the two biggest roles. Research, for example, has shown that children with one allergic parent have a 33% chance of developing allergies, and with two allergic parents, that number goes up to 70%. Genetics are also the reason African American children experience three times as much sensitivity to food allergens as Caucasian children. In science, we're always taught that early development is the most crucial stage of life, and early exposure to allergens is also no different. Research from Henry Ford Hospital shows that having a pet in the house during your child's first year of life may protect him or her from developing allergies. That same group also found that babies born via C-section were six times more likely to be sensitive to dust mite allergens than babies born via natural birth, presumably because they're not exposed to the microbiome of bacteria present in the mother's birth canal, which teaches their immune system the difference between good and bad bacteria. This goes hand in hand with something called the hygiene hypothesis, which aims to explain why allergies are more prevalent in wealthy, industrialized nations than developing countries. Again, the idea is that a lack of early exposure to parasites and bacteria typically found in developing nations prevents our bodies from being able to develop the appropriate immune response. So in the event we're actually exposed to dangerous agents, our bodies simply don't know how to deal with it. So what can we do about seasonal allergies if our bodies just refuse to cooperate? Antihistamines can alleviate the symptoms, but they're not going to make you any less allergic to something you're already allergic to. Some studies tout alternative remedies like acupuncture or eating locally grown honey, but most of those have anecdotal effects. The only proven treatment for respiratory allergies is immunotherapy, where you receive increasing doses of whatever allergen you're sensitive to, either orally or via injection. That slow buildup of allergens allows your body to acclimate to them, which in turn improves your long-term tolerance. Not only is this an expensive option if you don't have insurance, it's also a time-consuming process that can take months or even years. In the most extreme cases, people with severe allergies can resort to rush immunotherapy, which is the same thing but done on a much tighter timeline. So instead of spreading out your doses over several months or years, you receive all of them in a week. One long, miserable, never-ending week. Still better than a lifetime of sneezing, though, that much I can tell you. I got tested for allergies my first year of college and discovered I was allergic to all 71 allergens they tested me for, including both American and German cockroaches. So, yeah, I'm pretty worldly. I know there's weirder stuff out there, though, so let us know what you're allergic to in the comments down below or hit us up on Twitter at DNews.